Victory in Jesus. Oh, page 130. But ain't gonna put up the big magical screen.
They have to do it up top then.
Brian, is it muted? 120, I can't read.
Y'all want to book us? We've got a little group going now, us three. We're traveling, looking for a bus. He did a good job, didn't he? Great job, stepping in, helping out. This is our prayer meeting time. If you have a praise report, prayer request, give that in, and then we'll gather around the altar for prayer. I want to remember those in Pigeon Forge. They'll be wrapping up tomorrow, and so remember those that'll be traveling home on Friday. Any requests? Yes. Great. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
daughter Shirley, right before we left for Israel, and she said she didn't want any type of medications to keep her going because she would not be coherent, and she was ready to see Jesus and ready to see Bob. That's her husband that went on. So let's remember Shirley Lau in our prayers. Yes.
Well, despite where I carried the wound back for 4 months plus, it's healed.
Amen.
No more bandages. Nothing. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And now I have a spot on my leg where they took a skin cancer off, and we're having a time getting that to heal. But in due time, the Lord
Amen.
Will take care of it. And
yes.
I just give him all the praise and the glory, and I am so glad that my belly
yes.
is healed.
Yes, amen.
And I don't have any more hole in it. So I just want to praise the Lord for that.
Amen. Let's remember, of course, Alan Andrews' father. They had the funeral today, so let's remember the Andrews family, and also we had the funeral for the Albert Pope family, so let's remember them as well. Yes?
Ann Nelson's daughter is home. Her name's Tootsie. They are having to give her intravenous medication for another 3 weeks. Then she has surgery at Tampa.
All right, let's remember that. I do want to remember Donna Terry's not doing well, and she actually needs someone to stay with her. So I talked to Betty Wood, actually texted me, if you're interested in doing that, please see me after church. She's needed someone to kind of help her around. That's Donna Terry. So let's remember her in prayer as well. Any others? Yes.
Barbara called me just before I left, and she's not feeling good tonight, but that's why she's not here.
All right.
And also, Paula's husband, Pastor Phil, he found out yesterday, he went to a VA, and he has cancer, and they don't give him much chance. Mm-hmm. And so we need to remember him, too.
Amen. Amen. Yes.
I have a praise report. My 11-month-old grandson fell down the stairs and broke his elbow, but they didn't have to do the surgery. They put pins in it instead.
Amen. Amen.
They're going to watch it every week. You know, he has to go get an x-ray every week, but he didn't have to have the surgery.
Amen.
Sorry.
Any others? Any others? Yes.
Remember my son, please, Shay, facing a lot of difficulties with discipline and school and spiritual warfare.
Amen. All right. Let's remember him in prayer. Any others?
Yeah.
Yes.
Valley Parish.
Yes. Yes.
He's fighting a good fight, but he doesn't have, there's not a lot of hope there with that situation.
See him yesterday. His Jamie's sister was there, but he is not doing well. So let's remember Mally Parrish in our prayers. Yes.
I got a message from my cousin Betty Joe that my uncle Joe up in Atlanta area, he's got the same thing. My mom had Alzheimer's. He's been in and out of the hospital for the past week. Just remember him.
Amen. Let's remember that request. Yes.
Beth and Ron Rickman.
Yeah, remember the Rickmans. Amen. Any others? Yes. Any others?
Well, Kim had an appointment with a hepatologist, a liver specialist, and she got some pretty good results. They are going to do some genetic testing just to make sure as far as dad's condition, then where my liver stage is. But they had originally told her they were worried about some lymph nodes, and they were wanting to do a PET scan, and they've come back and said they don't need to do that, that everything's fine. So praise the Lord for that.
Yes.
And just continue to remember her as far as her liver functions, but they said if anything were to evolve, they know that it's definitely very early. So thankful for that.
Amen. Can you remember Kim?
Remember Brian Pope. His plane, he should be landing about 7:00.
All right. Let's remember Brian coming back from back surgery. So, yes, let's remember him in prayer. Sure.
Well, I had a granddaughter. She fell off a ladder. Second round up, she fell off. Her knee is shot. She's going to have an operation. She don't know when. She goes to the doctor this Thursday. They're Friday to find out what has to be done. But also keep sending her for your prayers. She's got a migraine headache. She's had it all day long.
All right, let's remember those requests. Any others? Any unspoken requests? Raise your hand and come up and sing this. All that will gather around the altar as we sing.
Sweet hour of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer. Sweet from a world of care. And bids me at my Father's throne, makes all my wants and wishes known. In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief. Till from Mount Pisgah's lofty heights I view my home and take my flight. This robe of flesh I'll drop and rise to see. Realize how to run south. I pray for the leadership.
come for tonight's offering. Everything you give goes to the Good Samaritan Fund. We love to try to help out those in need, whether that be food or different things. And so we want to remember that. Appreciate Sonny heading that up for us. Everything you give tonight goes to that. Ed Drum, would you pray for us? Bibles, turn to 1 Samuel chapter 17. We're starting a new study on Wednesday nights called The Land and the Book. We're going to be visiting the Holy Land the next 8 to 10 weeks. Now, let me get this straight. It's nothing like being there in person. Okay, you got to be there in person. But we're going to show you some pictures and read the stories that they take place there. And Ace kind of started it off on Sunday night. Didn't he do a great job on Sunday night with the Gideon Spring? And so we'll be having some of the fellas, they'll be speaking. Kevin and Chris, they spoke up there. And we even had Dennis and Charlie read some stuff. It was great. And so we're gonna be looking across basically our trip, the places we visited and things we studied there. So we'll be looking at that for about the next 8 to 10 week. So 1 Samuel chapter 17, if you have your Bible, stand with us. First Samuel chapter 17. Begin reading in verse number 1. 1 Samuel 17, verse number 1. The Bible says, "Now the Philistines gathered together their armies to battle, and were gathered together at Soko, which belongeth to Judah, and pitched between Soko and Azekah in Ephes-Damim. And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together and pitched by the valley of Elah, and set the battle in array against the Philistines. And the Philistines stood on a mountain on the one side, and Israel stood on a mountain on the other side, and there was a valley between them." Would you pray with me? Lord, we love you. We thank you, God, for your many blessings. I pray that you just be with those, Lord, that cannot be here tonight, those who are on beds of affliction. We want to lift up those who had prayer requests tonight, you know, each and every need. God, I pray that you just be with them. Be with those that are in Pigeon Forge tonight. We pray that you continue to bless that meeting and be with those who will be traveling home. And just give us a good night tonight, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. The most famous battle described in the Old Testament was not fought between two armies. It was fought between two people. It was a fierce battle that was fought in the what's called the Valley of Elah. It's between a shepherd boy and a giant. Now, the Valley of Elah, it's no small place. It's more like a vast canyon. Scholars say that this ancient site was close to a mile wide, and it happened to have a stream running through the middle of it, but I think somebody was just there. Oh, yeah, we were. So I'm going to show you some pictures to kind of set the stage. Go ahead and show that first one there. This is just an aerial view. I took this when I jumped out of an airplane in Israel last week. It was amazing. Just kidding. But this kind of gives you an idea of what's taking place. Can you see the little green thing here? Here it is over here. Look at it. See it? I'm going to follow it over. All right, you got it? Okay, that's Soko right there. We just read about that in verses 1 through 3. This is where some of the Philistines are, and here's Azekah over here. And if you look right here in the middle, there's Elah Valley right there in the middle. Thank you, guys. Appreciate that. Show the next picture. This is a better picture. This is, again, one side where the Israelites would have been towards the Elah Valley. You can see on the other side, this is where all the Philistines would have been. Now look right here. See this little stream going right across there? That is the little bed stream where the water would be flowing, and David is about to choose his stones. Go ahead and show the next picture. You can see it a little bit better. These are actually our pictures right here. This is us. Here is the stream bed right here. It goes for miles. You show the next one. It's a straight shot view. So there it is. This is where the stream ran through between the Philistine army and the Israelite army. And so we find that in chapter 17 of 1 Samuel that the Philistines are on one side of the mountain. The Israelites are on the other side of the mountain. And so the stage is set for one of the greatest stories ever told in the Bible. So tonight, I just want to, for a few moments, look at this story of David and Goliath. And I want you to see how David handled not only Goliath, but how he also handled a spirit of fear. Now, you do know that fear is a spirit. Amen? 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us the spirit of fear. So if God has not given us this spirit, where do you think it comes from? I'll give you one guess. From Satan. That's who. And I'll be honest, I've never seen more Christians battling fear, worry, anxiety than ever before. Whether it's the fear of death, fear of loneliness, fear of the economy, fear of all sorts of things. So I want you to notice with me tonight how David will handle this fearful spirit and how you and I must handle it as well. But to do this, we must see what takes place in this story in the Elah Valley. First thing I want you to notice about this story is this champion named Goliath. Look down in verse number 4. The Bible says, and there went out a champion out of the camp of the Philistines named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. Now, you and I don't measure things in cubits and spans. We measure in feet and inches. But most believe Goliath was anywhere between 9 to 10 feet tall. One commentary said that they believed he was 13 feet 4 inches. Think of that. It all depends how many inches you think a cubit might be. Regardless, if he was 9 feet tall or 13 feet tall, this guy is massive in size. Most believe he weighed between 400 to 600 pounds. And if you were to add the height and length of his arms as he lifted them over his head as he came at you, can you just imagine how intimidating this creature named Goliath must have been? But it wasn't just his natural size that made him so big. On top of that, the Bible says that he wore this body of armor. In fact, the biblical narrative spends a great deal of time describing Goliath's appearance. Goliath appears in only one chapter of the Bible, yet 4 verses are dedicated to describing his appearance. Look what it says in verse 5. And he had a helmet of brass upon his head, He was armed with a coat of mail, and the weight of that coat was 5,000 shekels of brass. That means Goliath's armor weighed close to around 200 pounds. How would you like a 500-pound man with 200-pound armor on to run at you and accidentally trip and just fall on you? Next, it describes the weapons that he used. Look at verse 7. And just the staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron. Just the head of his spear, we're looking at 20 to 25 pounds. And if that's not intimidating enough, verse 4 says that he was the champion. Now, we have to remember something very quickly before we move on, that back then in the Old Testament, they fought to the death. So if he's the champ, guess what? He ain't ever lost. You know why? He's still alive. No telling how many people Goliath had killed. No doubt the odds were against anyone foolish enough to face this champion in battle. So first of all, we see Goliath the champion, but notice now second with me, Goliath's challenge. Verse number 8, and he, Goliath, stood and cried unto the armies of Israel and said unto them, why are you come out to set your battle in array? Am not I a Philistine, and ye servants to Saul? Choose you a man for you, and let him come down to me. If he be able to fight with me and to kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then shall ye be our servants and serve us. So understand, Goliath was using a tactic commonly used in the Eastern world. He was challenging Israel to a one-on-one fight. Goliath would represent the Philistines. Whoever Saul chose would represent Israel. And the winner of this one-on-one match to the death would win the entire battle, and the losers of the army would be their servants. Easy enough. Obviously, Goliath being the champion, he's yet to lose a match, so I'm sure the Philistine army loved this strategy, don't you? I mean, wouldn't you want to be in the Philistine army knowing someone's going to fight on your behalf? So Goliath's saying, hey, fellas, there's no reason for our entire army to get into this. Just send a fighter out. I'll take him on. I'm the champion. Send out a challenger. And whoever wins, they win the entire war, and we will be your servants or you will be ours. It's that easy. But what I find interesting is that Goliath didn't issue this challenge just once. No, he did it for 40 straight days. In fact, verse 16 says that twice a day, morning and evening, Goliath came out and taunted Saul and his army for 40 days. Think about it, flaunting his size, showing off his strength, daring someone from Israel to take him on. Now, I want you to think with me for 1 second. Isn't that just like the giants of fear and worry? See, fear doesn't just show up once. If you allow it, fear will come in the morning. And if you allow it, fear will come in the evening, day after day, always trying to intimidate you. Whether it's in the form of a person, whether it's in the form of a health issue, maybe your job, whatever it may be, prepare yourself, because fear and worry will try to hammer on your mind day in and day out, just like Goliath did Israel. And to think, while this battle is going on, about 10 to 12 miles away, is a little shepherd boy keeping his father's sheep. He probably didn't even know who Goliath was. But very soon, he would be facing the greatest battle of his life. And I want you to understand, that's just how our personal battles usually are, aren't they? They just show up. You never know when they're coming. 1 minute you're quietly keeping sheep, the next minute you're in the battle for your life. So at the request of his father, David unknowingly heads towards a showdown with a giant. And as he comes over the last hill, he hears a man cursing the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And it's here he's first introduced to this champion named Goliath. I want you to see what it says in verse 25. And the men of Israel said, have you seen this man, talking about Goliath, that has come up? Surely to defy Israel is he come up. And it shall be that the man who killeth him, the king will enrich him with great riches and will give him his daughter and make his father's house free in Israel. So get this, King Saul has devised a nice little incentive plan for the man who will take on Goliath. If you will take him on, I'm going to promise you riches. I'm going to promise you my daughter in marriage. I'm going to promise your family exempt from taxes and military. And listen, that's a pretty good deal. But then I read it again and noticed, you didn't just have to face Goliath. What'd you have to do? You had to kill Goliath. See, he wouldn't give these things to someone who would just fight Goliath and die with honor. No, that person has to kill the champion. Well, guess what? Even this incentive plan wasn't enough to prompt anyone to step forward and say, I'm going to fight Goliath. But when you think about it, who was the most qualified to fight Goliath in the first place? Out of all the Israelites, the Bible says King Saul stood what? Head and shoulders above all the Israelites. So whereas Goliath was the giant of the Philistines, we have King Saul, the giant of the Jews, but he's wanting to pass this on to someone else. There's something else I want you to see. Did you notice where Goliath was standing on this particular day? Don't miss this. He's not in the same place. He's moved. If you remember when Goliath first called out to the Israelites wanting to pick a fight, the Bible says at the end of verse 8 that Goliath cried to the army of Israel and said, choose you a man and let him come down to me. But notice where Goliath is located on this day. Look how far he has moved in verse 25 when David comes on the scene. Again, verse 25 says, and the men of Israel said, have you seen this man that has what? Come up. Surely to defy Israel has he come up. So get this, Goliath has now crossed that little ravine in the valley of Elah, and he's now headed up Israel's side of the mountain, taking over their territory. And I must tell you, Christian, if we tolerate a giant in our life, if we allow fear and worry and anxiety to control our life, I promise you it will take over your life. It will take over your territory. It will move into your camp. It will take your thoughts continuously. One writer said this, anxiety is a thin stream of fear that trickles through the mind. And if encouraged or meditated on, will cut a wide channel that drains away all other thoughts. See, that's why as Christians we cannot tolerate giants, but instead we must kill them with God's help. And David does something very powerful here. Before ever going out to fight Goliath, I want you to notice what David does before anything else. He is now standing before King Saul. And King Saul says, how can you, a shepherd boy, possibly think you're going to defeat Goliath, the champion? Listen to what David says in verse 37. David said, moreover, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine. Before David ever goes out to battle against this undefeated champion, David first starts remembering, then recalling all the victories God had brought him through in the past. How many times have we faced a problem that we just seemed in our mind to be monumental? Maybe it's something that is currently happening to you right now. You see no way out. There's no place to turn. Yet many times we've forgotten all the victories God brought us through in the past. Do you believe God is the same God today, yesterday, today, and forever? Can he not do things today as he did yesterday? But isn't it true? We forget what we ought to remember, and we remember what we ought to forget. We remember lives in vivid detail. Yet many times we're hard-pressed to recall the miraculous victories God has pulled off for us in the past. But David was not going to forget. He said, Saul, you know why I can fight and win against this undefeated Philistine? Because the same God who gave me victory over the lion and the same God who gave me victory over the bear is the same God who will give me victory over this Philistine. I love that. David stands before the most powerful man in Israel and begins to give him his qualifications for defeating this undefeated giant. But notice, it's not about him. He said the same God who did this. You know what the Bible said? It's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by his Spirit, saith the Lord. Let us not forget what God's brought us from in the past. And allow us that to comfort us in times when we're feeling afflicted. So I want you to notice the story. We have this champion named Goliath. We have the challenge of Goliath. Now I want you to notice the courage of David. Little David heads down the hill to face Goliath. And I'm wondering, what do you think the army of Israel is thinking right now? As they watch this little shepherd boy walk down a hill to take on this giant. I promise you, there was not a soldier in either army giving David a chance. Remember, this is winner take all. You win, you kill the other person. And as David approaches the enemy, notice what happens. I love this. Verse 43. I want you to put yourself in David's shoes right now. Here you are. Verse 43, Goliath says, am I a dog that you come to me with staves? That word staves means a stick. And then he begins to curse David by his own gods. Verse 44, come here, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. Do you see what Goliath's trying to do? Before the battle has ever begun, Goliath is trying to intimidate David. Before he ever draws a spear or uses his sword, Goliath tries to use intimidation as a weapon. And Christian, listen, that will be your major battle when you face your giant. When Satan intimidates us, our thoughts get confused. We forget how to pray. Sometimes we lay out of church or we focus on the odds against us. And in the end, we forget who we represent. Better yet, who's representing us. But I love David's response. Verse 45, this is classic. Thou comest to me with a sword and a spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts. You know what he's saying? Really, how big was Goliath to God? Think about it. The creator of the universe. How big is Goliath to God? David's eyes weren't on this big giant. David's eyes were on his bigger God. My favorite verse in this story, the next few verses, verse 48. And it came to pass when the Philistine arose. This indicates that Goliath was sitting. He's resting. Why not? You're the champion, right? 200 pounds of armor, not including your own weight. He's sitting, but now he's standing. And it came to pass when the Philistine arose and drew nigh to meet David, that David hasted and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. How many of Goliath's opponents, after Goliath stood to his feet and started going at his opponent, how many of his opponents started running at him? I don't know, if it was me, I'd have been running away from him. But here he is. David starts running, not from Goliath, but towards him. And I wish we could go into Goliath's mind right now. What do you think Goliath's thinking as he sees this puny little shepherd boy running at him? I'd like to think he thought, boy, I like this kid. He's got a lot of spunk. I mean, nobody's ever run at me like this. I hate that I have to kill him. Better yet, what's David's brothers thinking? Don't forget, they're in the army. The oldest, Eliab, he's in the army. Remember when he gets there, David gets there, Eliab says, "Hey, who's watching your few sheep, David?" And now David is going after the giant while his brother who's in the army is watching him. Do you think he might be thinking to himself, "What in the world am I going to tell Dad?" What's King Saul thinking? Is this the best we have? This kid is crazy. But here's where we see the two perspectives of David and Saul. Saul is always looking on circumstances. David is always looking at God. Saul looked at Goliath and said, "My goodness, he's so big, I can never win." But David looked at the same giant and thought, "My goodness, his forehead is so big, I cannot miss." And he runs at this giant. And he takes out his weapon of choice. A shepherd's weapon. Almost the toy of a child. A slingshot. Can't you see the army of the Israelites? "Oh yeah, that'll do it." No sword, no spear. Remember, Goliath is still a giant. He's still an imposing presence. So it's a sling and stone against the 200 pounds of armor. Who would you have picked? Be serious. If you didn't know how the story, who would you have picked? But as he runs at the giant, he hurls the stone. And who do you think directed that stone? I mean, it's all about God, right? God's going to give him the victory. And God directs it to the only place not protected. If you look at the Philistine army, their armor in that day, they wore helmets that covered the ears, the head, and there was just an opening right here. And I can just see that stone flying through the air. In verse 49, at the end of it, it says, "And the stone sunk in his forehead." Now I want you to take out your hand and feel your forehead right now. Do you feel that? There's no room for a stone to sink there. In fact, if a stone sinks there, guess what? You're knocked out. Concussion. You're out cold. And I would love to have been, this is the part I would have loved to have been on a hill and just seen. I just see Goliath start to wobble, right? Can't you see the army on both sides raised to their feet? And the Bible says that he falls forward. Someone said while we were in Israel, you know, when you get pushed back in the forehead, you fall backwards. But the Bible says he fell forward. Maybe that was God just giving him a little shove, don't you think? And all that armor comes crashing down to the ground. And I bet you could hear a pin drop on the Philistine side. But David wasn't finished, was he? He would take Goliath's own sword. Of course, he had to. All he had was a slingshot. The Bible says he cuts off Goliath's head. An act that not only guaranteed the victim's death, but also humiliated Goliath and his army, who were previously taunting and mocking him. Can't you just see him maybe holding that head up? And at the end of verse 51, it says, "And when the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they surrendered themselves and kept their promise just like they said they would," right? No, remember, this was a one-on-one battle. Whoever loses the battle, we become your servants. The Bible says, no, they fled. They didn't keep their end of the bargain. And I love this verse, verse 52, "And the men of Israel and of Judah, who was scared to death," remember, they didn't want any part of this, "they arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines." Boy, what confidence they have now. Yeah, now that the giant's headless, I'm ready to fight. Verse 54, David does something very odd here. It says, "And David took the head of the Philistine and brought it to Jerusalem. And he put Goliath's armor in his own tent." Now, why would David drag that huge spear and Goliath's sword back into his own tent? I mean, what use was it to him? It's too big. It's for a giant. Here's why I believe he did it. Because every morning that he woke up, guess what he'd see? He'd see those weapons. And that would remind him that against all odds, God won a tremendous victory for him. You see, the secret of David's life is found in verse 47, where he said, "And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." There it is. That's it. The battle you are facing today, whatever it may be, it is not yours. It's the Lord's. I want to ask you, are you trying to fight your own battle? Are you trying to win on your own strength? Can I tell you something? You can't do it. But God can. And David is proof that it can still happen. Let's move forward several years. I wonder, when David became king, if maybe he didn't have a trophy case in his kingdom. There over in the distance was the sword of Goliath. Next to the skull of the lion, down by the rug of that old bear. Maybe when his kids were growing up, if they might have asked, "Hey, Dad, what's that sword over there? Well, where'd this bear rug come from?" David could say, "Son, let me tell you of the victory God brought me through when I was just a shepherd boy." He had a trophy case of God's past victories. I ask you tonight as we close, where do you keep your past victories? Do you pass over them? Do you forget what God brought you through in the past? Parents, we have a younger generation coming up behind us. You know what? We need to be sure to tell them about our past victories. Pass on your lion and your bear stories. One writer put it this way, and I'll close with it. He said, "All God asks for from you is 5 smooth stones and a sling of faith, and God will take it from there." His heads are bowed and eyes are closed. You're here tonight, and you'd be honest, and maybe you'd say, I battle with worry. I battle with fear, anxiety. Just like Goliath, every morning and every evening it comes out and it taunts me. And I'm fearful, and I'm anxious. Causes discouragement, maybe even depression. You be honest tonight. No one's looking around. You say, "I struggle with that." You be honest. "I have fear. I have worry. Bless all the hands. I have anxiety of the unknown." Bless all the hands here tonight. So many hands here tonight. Listen to me. The battle is not yours. This fight is not yours. You cannot fight this battle. This battle is the Lord's. All God asks from you is 5 smooth stones and a sling of faith, and He'll do the rest. You're here tonight. Maybe you have a need in your life, a burden that you're carrying. You want to be remembered in prayer. Would you just slip up your hand by saying, "Pray for me"? God knows each and every heart. Bless those hands. Bless all the hands. Maybe you're here tonight, you have a loved one who's unsaved, they need Jesus in their life, you want to remember them in prayer. Would you just slip up your hand by that saying, "Pray for me"? Bless all the hands. We're going to get a song of invitation, and we're going to sing. And if any need to come and pray, maybe there's something in your life that you just need to lay before the altar and give it over to Him. Maybe there's some fear, some worry, a little anxiety of something that you need God to come through, and you've been worrying about it. I'm asking you, just give it to God. And let Him have it. Don't try to fight it yourself. You can't do it. Just give it over to him. What'd Peter say? Casting all your care upon him. Why? Because he cares for you. God, we love you. We thank you for this great story. What tremendous faith a little shepherd boy showed against the champion Goliath. But God, through the whole story, we see David was not relying on his own strength. Everything was pushed upward at you. Help us to do the same. Whatever battle, whatever we're facing today, help us to not see that as a challenge to us, but God, that we'll look upward and we'll give this challenge over to you. So many tonight that raised their hand, if there are some that need to just come and pray and lay it on the altar, I pray that they would and give it over to you. We love you. We thank you for your word. Help us to be obedient to it. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. So we stand together.
Page 161.
Jim sings for us. If you need to come and pray, would you come?
Jesus is tenderly calling thee home, calling today, calling today. Why from the sunshine of love wilt thou roam farther and farther away?
You need to pray tonight. Would you come? Announcements before we're dismissed. I want to remind you, Sunday's a big day. We start at 7 a.m. For our sunrise service at the Carlton residence, and then we'll have service here at 10:45, starting right at 10:45. And then following that, we have an Easter egg hunt for fifth grade and under. We'll give you more directions about that that morning. Any other announcements before we're dismissed? Yes.